Hi, welcome to this webinar on deep learning introduction to TensorFlow. My name is Vivek Singhal. I am a co-founder and chief data scientist at Selfstrat. Okay, let's continue here. Just a brief intro to our startup Selfstrat. We are a leading AI startup in India based in Bengaluru, India, and we work in research and innovation in the space of artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. And we are working on multiple machine learning innovations and solutions for different industry verticals. In our most recent offering, we are setting up an AI lab where we'll be doing a lot of innovation. So I see some questions are already coming in, so I'll try to explain them slowly, but let me get into the topic first. Before I come back to your technical questions on the subject. So we are somewhat of a thought leader on LinkedIn and other social communities. We are in connecting with global AI data scientists. Some of them are very renowned names, and we hope to work with global scientists to create world-class disruptive innovation. Let me just move on from here. Just a brief intro about myself. I was based in the US for 16 years. I worked with AT&T last in the US as a lead technical architect. A few years back, I returned to India, my original native country, and worked with IBM India for 2 years. And last 4 years, I've been running a couple of startups. My recent startup being Selfstrat, which is an AI solution and research startup. We are working on multiple, algorithmic design and solutions in the area of machine learning, deep learning, including, regression, image processing, NLP, language translation, time series, and so on. We produce a lot of content in AI and machine learning space, some of it, which you can find it on our research blog. We have active webinars every week, of which this webinar is part of, and we post our recorded webinars on our YouTube channel. And the link of that channel is available on our Meetup page. So we have produced a lot of research and training content for several customers and educational companies in India. So that was just an intro my startup and myself. Let me come to the main topic now. So let's get started with TensorFlow, okay? So what is TensorFlow? So TensorFlow is one of the most popular machine learning libraries. If you are in this session, I hope you understand machine learning already to some extent. If you don't, then yes, this session may be a bit difficult for you, but try to understand or listen in. But my hope is that most of you have some idea about machine learning if you are in this session. So TensorFlow is an advanced topic, and TensorFlow is the name of an open source library in Python, originally produced by Google and now managed by the open source community. And it provides us a lot of predefined algorithms in neural networks, in regression, in classification, and many other similar machine learning algorithms. Now, so somebody saying they want to see other people's question. Well, this tool GoToWebinar does not allow the audience to see each other's question. So when I address people's question, I'll be repeating them for the benefit of others who don't see the question, okay? So let me come to the questions, but let me first get into the topic a little bit. And I have a lot of content to cover, so I'll keep moving at a pretty brisk pace, okay? All right, so I was on TensorFlow. So TensorFlow, is written in C++, C, which Google always likes to use, most of the software companies, but it's a Python overlay. And we can develop TensorFlow code in Python. And here, TensorFlow has an interesting execution dynamics. It uses this concept of computation graph, okay? So this is what you see the graph here. So this is the kind of graph it creates in memory, okay? So for example, this equation, if I am trying to implement with help of TensorFlow, so I have put an X here. So it's a tree kind of graph, X into X, right? Then a plus of what? X into X, and then Y. So this is X square plus y into y plus y, because there is a, so this is a plus sign here. Let me just put the sign here. This is a plus sign here. This is a multiplication sign, by the way. Sorry, they all look alike. So x square, these two x square into y plus y again. So x square into y plus y again, and then plus 2. All right. So if you notice carefully, this is how the equation is forming. Now let me just clean it up. So x square into y plus y plus 2, right? So this is how this equation is forming. The so computation graph is a graph of the operation in memory. Okay, this is what TensorFlow does. It first creates a graph of computations to perform, right? Each of these operations count as a computation, isn't it? And these are parameters in memory, x, y, and 2. 2 is a constant, plus and multiplication are operations, and x and y are variables. Okay, so these are called elements of TensorFlow, parameters of TensorFlow. And then it creates this computation graph, and during session runtime, so initially when I created the computation graph, it was not actually run. The run happens in phase 2, and phase 2 is the session runtime. So I open a session and then I run this graph, and it executes that entire equation. Okay, calculates that equation. So this TensorFlow was developed by Google Brain team initially, and it has been used extensively in all Google applications. And now it is an open source and the most popular deep learning library by far. So TensorFlow supports algorithms like artificial neural networks of various kinds. It supports regression algorithms such as linear regression and polynomial regression and the like, right? So it supports various machine learning algorithms in that sense. You could do these algos using old techniques like scikit-learn in Python, or just plain raw Python. But TensorFlow gives us nice wrapper APIs around these complex machine learning algorithms, making our life simple. But still, it is not so simple. TensorFlow code also looks fairly complex in nature. Okay, let me go on to the next slide. Shortly I'll come to your questions. I see a lot of questions are coming in. All right. So TensorFlow has two kinds of APIs. Okay. So TensorFlow has two kinds of APIs. One is the core API, and it has other higher level APIs such as contrib.learn, layers, or even Keras. So Keras was a third party deep learning library, but now it is running on top of TensorFlow. Keras was a high-end library. It always needed a backend such as Theano or TensorFlow. Theano was an old, deep learning library, no longer used now. Mostly it is TensorFlow or PyTorch, which has become dominant now. Okay, so PyTorch is the second most popular library produced by Facebook originally, now in open source domain. Okay, so TensorFlow core API and higher level API. So core API requires slightly more intricate programming work. Higher level APIs, reduce the amount of code you have to write and simplify the TensorFlow coding work. All right. So let me continue here. So, okay. So TensorFlow operates around the concept of tensors, right? So everything in machine learning, everything is a data matrix, right? So a tensor is a set of values shaped into an n-dimensional array. So if you are familiar with your arrays, an array looks like this, right? Some value here, value here, value here. So this is a two-dimensional matrix, right? Why is it a two-dimensional matrix? Because rows, then column, right? And each cell here has a value, right? That's what is a two-dimensional matrix or 2D matrix. Now you extend this into a 3D matrix. So there is a depth dimension. So it becomes a three-dimensional matrix. Now in your mind, you have to extrapolate that to an n-dimensional matrix. So in most machine learning problems in real life have n-dimensional structures. So you can only visualize them in your mind. On the paper, you can only plot a two-dimensional matrix, right? How do I plot a third dimension, right? So if I have two dimensions, at max, in a chart format, I could plot a third dimension, right? going inside and so on, right? X, Y, Z, three-dimensional structure, three-dimensional geometrical chart. In metrics, how do I plot it? So you have to just imagine. So there's a third dimension, which is a depth dimension. And then in reality, we may have an n-dimensional structure. So a tensor is nothing but an n-dimensional matrix, okay? And a tensor's rank is number of dimensions. If it's a 2D matrix, we call it a 2D tensor. If it is a 3D matrix, we call it a 3D, tensor or rank. The rank is number of dimensions, all right? And so, for example, 3, just the value 3, just the value 3. It's a rank 0 tensor because it is a scalar value. It doesn't have any dimension. It's not even within an array, okay? However, if I write 3 like this, there's a difference in writing 3 like this and 3 like this. The first 3 is a scalar value. It has 0 dimension. This 3 is within a 1x1 array. It becomes a tensor or a rank 1 tensor. So this is rank 1 tensor. It has 1 dimension, right? So 1 dimension. So rank 1 tensor. All right, but if it is just 3, it's a scalar. So that's why it's a rank 0 tensor, 0 dimensions for a scalar. And this is with shape this, right? And 1, 2, 3 is a rank 1 tensor because it has 1 dimension with shape 3. So shape is just 3 cells, right? So that's why 1, 2, 3. This one is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? A rank 2 tensor because it has 2 dimensions. And it has shape 2x3, a rank 3 tensor. So it has 3 dimensions. So why 3 dimensions? Dimension 1, dimension 2, dimension 3, right? This was 1 dimension, this was 2 dimensions, this is 3 dimensions, okay? And this has a shape of 2, 1 and 3, all right? So it can get pretty intricate. We have to just get used to this kind of data formats and then be able to operate on them. So it can get a bit confusing at times, but in reality, machine learning problems are dealing with data sets which may have n-dimensional structure. So it is quite normal and you need to get used to it. So I see 72 people have joined so far. I really appreciate such a big interest in this topic. And thanks for your time. I hope I can make this session very useful for you. Okay, let me just address a few questions for now. I see quite a few questions are already in the pipeline. Okay, so first question is, hi, I want an entry-level job in machine learning. Okay, well, so the last few slides, I do have some career counseling discussion in AI and machine learning. So if you could kindly hold till the end, I'll be discussing some questions around careers in AI and machine learning, okay? So I always have that in my webinars towards the end. Okay, so next question is, explain learning rate decay, dying neuron, vanishing gradient, data augmentation, Xavier initialization in terms of deep learning topics. So I'll be covering a few of these in this 1 hour webinar, but not all of these. Some of them are complex topics requiring a larger discussion. So we in SelfShred, we offer online training in machine learning, deep learning and TensorFlow. And I teach those classes personally. So you can check out those courses on our website or on our meetup page and sign up for them. I'll be teaching a deep learning class in November, starting November 13, every Tuesday and Thursday in the evenings. You can find that on our meetup page. You can sign up there, okay? So there we'll be discussing a lot of these concepts in sufficient detail. In a 1 hour webinar, I'll just be touching on a few of these topics. Okay, what are the different optimization techniques? Is momentum an optimization technique like ADAM and RMS prop? Absolutely. So momentum optimization is also a comparative optimizer compared to ADAM or RMS prop, right? And there are others as well, like gradient descent optimizer. Okay, looking for an entry level job in AI? Well, I'll come to some career questions towards the end of this webinar. This library can be used in Python alone, also for R. See, I'm a Python developer. I don't have exposure to R. So as far as I understand, TensorFlow is Python-based library. I don't think it's available in R, but don't hold me to it. So kindly Google it and you can find that out. I believe TensorFlow is only Python because I only deal with Python, so I don't have any knowledge about R. How do one handle overfitting, underfitting, bias, variance, trade-off, and deep learning? It's a big topic. So it's we also discuss it in our machine learning webinars, you know. So we'll come to this, you know, some of it. So overfitting can be handled by regularization. Underfitting can be handled by more data or changing the algorithm. Bias versus variance trade-off is also about overfitting and underfitting, right? So it's a big topic. You can see some of our other webinars where we have discussed this as well. A multi-dimensional array matrix. Yes, so a matrix, multi-dimensional array, these terms are coming from data science or mathematics, so you can use it. You can use it interchangeably, yes. And can you please tell why Google develops it? It was a limitation in other open source libraries. Yes, so Google developed TensorFlow because it wanted to advance its, you know, deep learning leadership, right? So artificial intelligence leadership. So initially TensorFlow was developed by Google for its own applications. Later on, they found they can launch it for public usage as well. And now Google TensorFlow is the dominant deep learning library, right? So initially a lot of this technology was developed for Google by Google for its own, you know, applications like Google Photos, Google Translate, and so on, Google searches. Rank is the subscript of array. No, rank is not the subscript of array. Rank is the number of dimensions of the n dimensional array. So n dimensional array has rank n. Okay, simple. Can the last one be 2, 3, 1 also? Not really. The order is important. The order in which you write the data is very important, and the shape accordingly. So 2, 3, 1 shape is not same as 2, 1, 3 shape. It's different. Okay. What is the best way to get in deep learning? Best way to get deep learning into deep learning is you please take up our courses. You know, just to pitch my courses again. I mean, that said, you know, I mean, if you really want to become a world's top AI expert, I suggest you do a PhD in machine learning from a top university. Outside of that, you can do MSc or MS from a top university. If not, you can do some of these courses, including the kind of courses offered by my company. All right. Can explain what is Keras now? See, Keras is a front end for deep learning. It simplifies neural network development, but it does use TensorFlow or Theano as backend. Okay. Any advantage of TensorFlow over PyTorch? PyTorch is a computing library initially proposed by Facebook, but now in open source. But somehow Google has the dominant lead on it and TensorFlow is more popular. But I believe PyTorch is also very popular and you can check it out. So these can be used interchangeably. I have not worked in PyTorch. At some point I might. I'm new to ML and AI. I have confusion where to start. So I mentor a lot of folks in about our careers in AI and machine learning. Please contact me offline. I'll be happy to spend time with you. You know, so this requires a longer discussion about getting into AI and ML careers. Happy to discuss one-on-one with anybody who needs career mentorship. Does Create ML and Core ML of Apple use TensorFlow? So I'm not sure about Apple, what they use, okay? So Apple has a lot of artificial intelligence in its infrastructure, iPhone and you know, Apple iTunes, but I'm not sure what tech they use. How to choose number of filters and filter size, number of layers for creating a model. Some of it are hyperparameters from deep learning. So hyperparameters are those parameters decided by the data scientist, all right? So they are not learned by the program. All right, I continue to see a lot more questions coming in, but in interest of time, I have to keep moving. I'll try to come back to questions a little later. Okay, so as we were discussing, TensorFlow operates by creating a computation graph in memory first. I showed you a graph, right? So so here I am creating, this is how I would write TensorFlow code, okay? So I would say import TensorFlow as TF, short form TF. Then I declare a variable on the graph, right? So the moment I do that, on the graph, a variable gets created, right? By this statement. When I do this, a variable Y gets created. Okay, so this is the graph forming in TensorFlow memory, right? TensorFlow runtime. And then the moment I do this, it creates that other graph which we saw, right? We saw that graph and the big graph is on the first slide, right? So this is where this operation gets created. This operation, actually this complex operation having many sub operations, right? So this whole computation graph gets created here when as soon as I declare this. So by declaring these, by these code lines, the effect is that a computation graph is getting created. This code is not executed yet. This operation is not executed yet. It's merely creating the computation graph in memory, right? So this is called construction phase. To evaluate the graph, we need to open a TensorFlow session This is how we open a TensorFlow session, okay, tf.session, and then run it. Then we actually run it, and before we run it, we initialize the variables here, right? So we initialize the variables and then we run it, and then so we first and then we run the final. So we run x, so x runs, then y runs, then f runs, then we print the result, and the output is some value. We would have fed some value to it, so it because we fed this value, right? So it is, so what is this? 3 square into 4, right? Plus 4 plus 2, right? This is what this operation is, right? 3 square into 4 plus 4 into 2. Guess what? 9 into 4, 36 plus 4, 40 plus 2, 42. This is where we get 42, right? Let me just do one thing here. I don't like the color of my pen here, so I'm going to change it to perhaps a blue. Blue is more suiting to the eye. So this is where I got my 42, all right? And then we close the session. It's important to close the session, okay? So now you could see I had to call session.run multiple times, right? So instead of calling session.run like 3 times, I could just write it as that. So there is a Python has scope, right? So within this session scope, I do this. So I'm not having to call session.run, but I still have, I am having to call initializer.run. So initialize is still wasn't done, right? So it reduces the number of run calls. All right. So this just simplifies the code by nesting it within a if loop. Clear? So I'll just move to the next slide. Now, instead of initializing them one on one, as you can see, I'm initializing x and y separately. But here, I can just call a global variables initializer. What it will do, it will initialize x and y together. Okay, I don't have to initialize x dot initialize y dot initialize. And then again, within the session scope, right? This is scope because this is nested code. And you know, when it's nested, it goes in within the scope of that, over encompassing command, which is with. And then I just say run once and evaluate. So you see how code got simplified here. First, I did global initialization of x and y. Then I encapsulated the run and evaluate code within the with block. Okay. So this is a simplified version of the code on the previous page, right? And I could also do an interactive session. In interactive session, what it does, it sets up a default session. So one no longer needs a with block. So I can even dispense with the with block if I use an interactive session, okay? So if I use the interactive session instead of session, if this was session command, this is interactive session command of TensorFlow. So here I can run it without the with block, same effect, okay? It prints the result 42, right? Then I could do session close, clear? Simple enough TensorFlow code. Okay, let me just take up a question or two. For object detection, we can use TensorFlow. Absolutely. For object detection, we can use TensorFlow. Either we can use classic artificial neural networks, or we can use a specialized form of neural networks referred to as convolutional neural network, which TensorFlow offers, which will do a more accurate object detection in images. Okay. What is 1 in 2, 1, 3? As I am thinking, 2 and 3 are row and column. Okay. So somebody is asking a very fundamental question. Well, what is when I write a tensor? Okay. When I write a tensor, see, I told you, you can see a two-dimensional data here. Right, some value here, two-dimensional data, right? By the way, this is 3 rows and 3 columns, so it's a 3x3 matrix where it is 2D rows and columns. So now let's say I want to do 2 and 1. So if I do 2 rows 1 column, this is 2 1, this is 2 and 1. So I am now trying to represent this one here, okay? 2, 1, 3. So 2 rows, but 1 column. First row, second row, one column, right? So 2 and 1 is taken care of. What is 3? 3 means there is a third dimension going inside the paper, and it has 3 such instances. So it will actually look like this. Let me try to draw it out. Think that there are actually 6. Okay, there are 6 values. There are 6 values. So what you see in the front, behind this there is another. Behind this there is another. So 2 rows, 1 column, but 3 depth. Okay. So behind the what you see on the 2 dimensional, there is one more. Again, it has 2. It has 2. So this is where the 3 comes from. The depth is 3. It's a 3D structure as opposed to a 2D structure. Okay. It is a 3D structure. Okay, it is a 3D structure. So just imagine a 3D box. If I just take an empty cardboard, just a plain 2x flat cardboard, this is cardboard. But what if I want a box, not a cardboard? Isn't the cardboard look like this? Right? This is a cardboard box as opposed to a simple cardboard. So just a simple cardboard has these elements. But when I box it up, I have elements behind this element also, right? This becomes my third dimension. So this is how real world data looks like. It has multi-dimensional structure. Here I am just talking about a 3 dimensions, but in reality, the real life data sets could have n dimensions, you know. It could have hundreds of dimensions. You see, you cannot visualize it on paper. Alright? So this is how we have to deal with machine learning. They are complex data sets. We just need to know number of dimensions. We cannot visualize them on paper. We just visualize them in a 2D or 3D format and we extrapolate. All right. I hope that helps understand what is the meaning of an n-dimensional array, or also called a tensor. Okay. I see 80 people are on the call now. That's great. Appreciate your time. So, okay. So let me answer a few more questions before I go on. So which one is more preferred, Keras or TensorFlow? So you can do direct TensorFlow coding, but Keras really simplifies the code. I'll show you some of the Keras code later in this session. Keras simplifies TensorFlow coding. So it is preferable to use Keras front end and TensorFlow back end. Okay. But you can do direct TensorFlow based neural networks also. Doing MTech with ML/AI specialization at IIT MS in foreign universities. So I suggest, if you want to know which degree is better, PhD in computer science, specialization in machine learning from a top university like IIT, IISc, IIIT, or foreign Ivy League universities is the best. Second best is Master of Science in Computer Science, specializing in machine learning from the same universities. Third option is you can do some of these courses like the kind of courses my company offers. The fourth option is you can try to learn it on your own using portals like Coursera and Udacity, but most people fail to complete those courses. Completion rate on Coursera for the most popular Dr. Andrew Ng's ML courses, only 2%. 98% people in the ML course on Dr. Andrew Ng's course drop out in midway. This area is very hard. You need an instructor to teach you. That's what in my company we offer. I teach these courses online and I check each person's assignment on Coursera and Udacity. Nobody is checking your assignments. Okay, if you're highly motivated, you can use those self-learning portals. I highly recommend you take instructor-led classes. Okay, so these are the options to learn machine learning AI, get into these careers. In the global initialization code, print should be avoided. Print should be avoided. What do you mean by print should be avoided? So not necessarily. I mean, print can things print once things have been computed. You cannot print a computational graph. You have to run the session, then only you can print, because till the session runs is nothing to be printed. It was just merely a graph in memory. What type of models can be used for object detection? Convolutional neural networks are most specialized for image processing and object detection. Okay. How will the shape of 4D tensor be? We have to extrapolate. We cannot visualize it on paper. Just like I showed you a 2D cardboard and a 3D cardboard box with rows of data behind the front row, right? Front view. right? So you have to just imagine in your mind a 4D tensor. I cannot draw it on a graph, a 4D tensor. So in real life problems, you will have n-dimensional problem data sets. So you have to just imagine it. You cannot draw it on a graph. Cube. No, cube is not 3D. Cube is not 4D. Cube is only 3D. In cube, you can only see 3D structure, right? Cube or a cube or rectangular cube or a square cube has only 3D structure. How will 1, 2, 3 shape look like? Okay, how will 1, 2, 3 shape look like? Well, so somebody is asking, how will this shape look like, right? Let's draw it out. Okay. So first one row is only one, right? So there is one, but two columns. So there are two columns. So row is one, but columns are two, right? But there are three depth perception. So I need to draw the third depth also. So one row, but two columns. Then you draw the cardboard box behind it. Okay. Okay. You draw the cardboard box. Right. And you put two more in the back of the box. There you go. That's your 1, 2, 3 tensor. Okay. So there are six values. Notice one thing here. So the number of values is equal to 1 × 2 × 3, right? Which is total six. There are six elements in this tensor. So 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There are six elements in this tensor. One row, two columns, three depth. Yeah. I hope this is clear. I have to move on from this topic now. How to build own neural net like ResNet 50 ImageNet? Well, you can build, but it is suggested you use these pre-trained neural networks like VGG, ResNet or ImageNet, because developing these from scratch will take you a long time. You can, but it's better to use pre-built models, and you can download their code from GitHub. All right. Which tool is better for visualizing the output of each layer while training the model? So TensorFlow offers TensorBoard, which is a visualization tool. All right, very interesting visualization tool this TensorFlow offers for visualization of your machine learning model. Okay. Can you explain N-level data from a real life? Very simple. Take Amazon.com. Amazon.com has, let's say, 10,000 product categories. That's 10,000 dimensions for you. All right. 10,000 product categories on an e-commerce site called Amazon.com. That means 10,000 dimensions. Very, very complex problem to solve, right? So that's why Amazon.com has a massive machine learning team, and they hire some of the best data scientists. So I hope that gives you an example of an n-dimensional problem. So let me move on in interest of time a little bit further before I take questions. Will keep coming at a very rapid pace as we have 80 people on this call. Okay. Okay, any new node gets, see, so there was a computation graph. So the original graph is called the default graph, right? And any variable which we declare gets added to the default graph. When I check X1's graph, is it default graph? It says true, yes. So X1 got created on the default graph. The word is default graph, very important term, right? But I can create a variable which is not on default graph. So I can create multiple graphs in memory. So multiple computation graphs, right? So this one is, I am declaring an altogether new graph. So you can imagine if this is your default graph, I create a branch of it. So this is your default graph. Just imagine this is the default graph, the entire structure of the graph. I create a branch of it. This is the new graph, okay? Default graph, sorry, DG. So this is a new graph. So originally variables got created here unless I explicitly put them in the child graph. So here I am creating a child graph using this command. So when I say tf.graph, it creates a child graph, okay, of the default graph. And then I'm saying on this child graph, declare variable x2. So now x2 is not on default graph of the original program. X2 is on the child graph because it was nested within this with block. You see this nesting, right? when I check x2's graph is graph correct, because x2 was created on this new child graph, right? But when I check x2.graph is on the original program's default graph, it says false. So when I put this x2 creation within the with block of this graph, it created x2 on the child graph. So x1 was here, right? X1 was here, but x2 got created on the child graph. I hope this is clear, because I nested the creation of x2 within the with block. Okay. All right. Let me continue. Okay, so TF, so let's discuss some major elements of TensorFlow, which are used in TensorFlow graph. Okay, so we already saw a constant, y is equal to x square, z is equal to x square y plus 2. That 2 was a constant, okay, a parameter whose value never changes. Placeholder was simply when I said x is equal to TF dot placeholder. So placeholder is simply a bucket where I'll be placing some value later. I'll be providing a value later. So placeholder is a bucket variable, all right, where I'll be placing the exact value of the variable later. Feed dictionary specifies tensors that provide concrete values. So placeholder was created an empty bucket, and feed dictionary is the mechanism by which I'll be feeding the actual data values into the bucket, okay, later on. So feed dictionary is a mechanism to feed data into the placeholders or the buckets. Variables, we have already seen, variable are trainable parameters to a graph, right? Trainable parameters. So trainable parameters means these are the parameters which will be learned by the process of machine learning. So if you understand your machine learning, we are trying to learn the ideal value of weight W and bias B, isn't it? So I am creating a placeholder for W, weight, and bias B. I'm creating a variable, sorry, and I'm creating a value of X in which I'll be feeding. Because what is X? X is training data. As you know from your machine learning knowledge, X is training data. W and B constitute as weights, which are learned as part of the machine learning model training. X is training data. I create a placeholder or bucket variable for X, and later on using feed dictionary during session runtime, I'll be feeding the training data into X using feed dictionary, right? Feed dictionary is a mechanism by which I feed the data into placeholders or variables. To evaluate actual nodes, one runs a session. This is called TensorFlow runtime, as we have already seen. Okay, I hope this is clear. Let me move on. Okay, saving and restoring models. Saving and restoring models is a topic. Basically, here we serialize the model. See, in machine learning, we train a model, right? So how do you deploy the model to production? Whether it's classic machine learning or it is deep learning with TensorFlow, you need to deploy the trained model to production. What we do is we serialize. Those of you who, some of you who are from software may be familiar with the concept of serialization. We serialize the model or the program to hard disk so that we can retrieve it later during production or session runtime. So I can train a model and I can declare a saver node. This is called a saver node. So what it does, whatever the model is so far, it is captured by the saver. Okay, it is captured by the saver. So you can see I am opening a session, I initialize the session, I run, you know, so many epochs, so many session runs, and I save every 100 training passes, I save the session in the saver node. Okay, and finally I call the final one. So then this is the final checkpoint. So these points which I am saving to the saver node are called checkpoints. Okay, the word we use is checkpoint. It means a point in time, a point in time of the model training. So at every 100 training loops, 100 epochs, epoch is number of training loops, at after every 100 epochs, we will save the model checkpoint in the saver node. All right, that's why this is called after every 100 training epochs, but not in between. Okay, and then I run the training op, whatever the training op is, and then I have calculated the best theta values. What is theta? Theta is the weight or the parameter which has been learned as part of model training. Then I save the final checkpoint here. Okay, All right. So this is how we can save the model checkpoints, model views at that time, if you will. Or the snapshot of the model. Checkpoint is the snapshot of the model at that point in time. Okay. And then how do I reuse it later? I restore it. So what I do later on, I restore the final checkpoint, which I had saved in the last before, you remember from previous slide, and I restore. Okay. If I want to save only certain variables, not the entire model to the checkpoint, I can name the variables I want to save. So here I am saying only save the weights in the checkpoint. I am not saving other aspects of the graph. I am only saving the weights, which is weights are represented by the theta parameter, right? And they are saved to the saver node. So you understood how we can save and restore models for later use. So when I am deploying TensorFlow models in production, I would save them to the hard disk. It internally serializes the model. If you understand from your software knowledge, if serialization means storing the state of the program on hard disk. Later on, I can retrieve the model for reuse in production or testing. All right. I can also give it to my friend for further training the model. Okay. So this creates a sort of an intermediary point for us, for me to pick it up later, or my team to pick it up later. Because if I don't save it, I have to run the whole program again. Tomorrow I come back. Yesterday I ran 1 lakh or 1 million training loops. Tomorrow I come back, I didn't save anything. I have to restart from zero loop. I have to run 1 million training loops again. What I could do instead, before I go to home today, I could save my model with 1 million training loops, come back tomorrow morning, do a restore, and start training from after 1 million training loops, right? You don't want to repeat the whole process every day. This is how this save and restore helps. Let me continue. So now let's look at some high level APIs. So there are two high level APIs which are very popular, the TF layers API and Keras API. So what is high level APIs? It simplifies TensorFlow development. Okay. So Keras API is now part of TensorFlow install. Earlier Keras was outside of TensorFlow. It was an independent library. You could use another deep learning library called Theano as a backend for Keras front end. But now Keras is part of TensorFlow. You can use Keras in conjunction with TensorFlow backend. And what these high level APIs do, they simplify the process of creating a neural network. Okay. So Keras can be installed as a separate package. However, after TensorFlow 1.1.0, Keras is added to TensorFlow contrib submodule. All right. So let's see some code here. So how it looks like. So you can see Keras is allowing me to create a three-layered neural network very simply. First, I call a Keras model. I use a sequential API of Keras to create a Keras model. Then this is the first neural network layer. This is the second neural network layer. And this is the third neural network layer. Okay. So first layer is a fully dense, means fully connected neural network. So if you know your neural networks, it's a fully connected neural network. I'm using a special kind of variable initialization, glorot uniform, which allows you to prevent vanishing or descending gradients, vanishing or exploding gradients, right? And then I'm using 10H activation at the end of this layer. If you know your neural networks and activation function, second also is a fully connected layer because I'm using dense. Okay. Dense means fully connected. Again, glorot uniform initializer to prevent vanishing gradients problem. Local minima problems. And then now this is an MNIST. You know, if you know your MNIST, if you have done machine learning, you would have come across this data set called MNIST. What is MNIST? MNIST is a database of 70,000 handwritten numerical digits. So it's an optical character recognition data set where we train a model which can recognize handwritten numerical digits. Numerical digits range from 0 to 9, right? So that's why, since there are 10 numerical digits from 0 to 9, that's why I want to classify the input image of the numerical digit into one of 10 classes, the 10 classes being digit 0 to 9. That's why I'm creating 10 output levels, and I'm applying softmax activation in the last layer, which means classify the incoming image into one of the 10 classes, whether the incoming image belongs to, is it 0 or is it 1 or is it 2 or 3 or 4 or whatever, right? So there are 10 possible numerical values from 0 to 9, right? So it does image recognition. It identifies the handwritten numerical digit. So three layer neural network declared in just three lines of code. This is what Keras does. So if I were to do this in TensorFlow, it would take many more lines of code to develop a three layer neural network. First layer, second layer, third layer. Okay, I'll leave it at that. Let me, you just saw the code, how simplified a three layer neural network became. This is why we recommend Keras usage. Okay, and then later on you just declare an optimizer. In this case I am using stochastic gradient descent or SGD optimizer with a momentum optimizer setting of 0.9, right, and a decay, learning rate decay, an initial learning rate, but I am decaying the learning rate to prevent, you know, my model from getting stuck in local minima, right? And then I create a stochastic gradient descent SGD optimizer, and I compile the model, and I'm using cross entropy loss. So one of the loss functions you can use in machine learning is mean square error, MSE loss, or cross entropy loss. Here I am using cross entropy loss. It is one kind of loss function to use in machine learning, right? So I declare a stochastic gradient optimizer and then cross entropy loss. Then I train the model using this optimizer. Okay, and I'm decaying the learning rate. Okay, so that learning rate gets adjusted at each epoch. We do this to prevent vanishing gradients problem of neural networks. Okay, all right, let me continue here. So if you don't know your basic machine learning, it may look daunting to you. So that's why the order of things is very important. First you have to learn machine learning, then you have to learn a bit of deep learning, then you can start using TensorFlow, then you go to advanced neural networks with TensorFlow. You cannot directly come to TensorFlow and deep learning without having mastered machine learning. Okay, so the order is very important. Otherwise, a lot of these terminology will be Greek for you, unfortunately. Then finally, I do a model.fit. Okay, I call a model.fit, and then it finds the ideal model when I call model.fit. And I'm printing the loss after every 50 training loops, right? After every 50 training loops, I'm printing the loss. So you can see the loss is going down slowly, right? So as I do more training iterations, this is my 50th training iteration. At the end of each train, there are 50 total training iterations. At the end of each training iteration, I'm printing the loss. The loss is now going down, 7.72, 0.37, 0.30, 0.404. Right, so verbose one means I'm doing 50 training loops with a batch size of, so this is batch gradient descent, as you know, so 64 batch size. Verbose one means print the output of the optimization process after each epoch, right? And validation split means reserve 10% of training data for validation after each epoch. Okay, so training and validation data split. If you don't know classic machine learning, this will be difficult for you. I can appreciate that. So this assumes you are expert in machine learning already. So finally, we can use, once we have a trained model, we can use the model to predict the results for test data or put it in production, use it for production data, right? So if I have time, I'll show you a small tutorial in this, but for the interest of time, let me go on for now. The TensorFlow is complex. It's not very easy, as you can see. It requires some expertise in machine learning as well as some knowledge of deep learning. So TensorFlow is nothing but a tool for visualizing the model training process in TensorFlow. I'm not going to be able to spend a lot of time on this. This is just an online visualization tool where I can see how the losses, I can see variety of things. This particular graph shows how the cross entropy. So this is cross entropy loss, which we have declared. The cross entropy loss is going down with subsequent epochs of the training run. Okay, this is number of training loops. and the cross entropy loss is declining, as you can see, right? Finally, it will sort of saturate here. We have found our ideal number of epochs. So if the training loss sort of saturates, flatlines here, this is the number of training loops we should run, right? We can stop the model training here because this, after this, the model will not reduce the loss any further. So TensorFlow is a very interesting online visualization tool, which will show you in your web browser the output of your or the model training process, the inside mechanics of your model training process with TensorFlow. All right, but not going to be able to cover a lot of details on this. Let me continue. Okay, so before I go to a career discussion in AI and machine learning, let me address some of the questions which are now has come in since. We have quite a few questions. Okay. Which one is more preferred, Keras or TensorFlow? As I said, recommended is Keras front-end, TensorFlow back-end. That's a recommended architecture. But you can use pure TensorFlow also using tf.layers or TFS or TensorFlow estimator library. Okay. In the global initialization code, print should be added. So you should not print anything before you run the computation graph, before the session is run, because there's nothing to print. Computation graph doesn't mean anything has been executed yet. It is just creating the graph in memory. Okay, let me keep going here. How to build own neural network? We already said better to use, if you have complex application problem, you should use pre-trained neural network from ResNet, VGGNet, you know, ImageNet, etc. It just makes your life simpler. Training a complex neural net from ResNet from scratch is extremely hard, especially for folks who are not long-time experts in this. Which tool is better for visualizing the output of each layer? We already said TensorFlow. How to get rid of false positive detection when we perform transfer learning on pre-trained model? So pre-trained model, removing false positive. So removing false positive is just, you know, hyperparameter tuning, data pre-processing. So if you see false positive in your testing, you'll have to go back to data preparation step and try to see if you can remove false positive or otherwise do model tuning. There is no specific formula. Can tensor be visualized by Tableau? See, I'm not familiar with Tableau, so I cannot comment on it. I doubt Tableau can visualize tensor. Tableau is a reporting tool, as what I have heard from other people, but I have never worked on it, so don't hold me to it. What is the use of creating a new graph? Can you give an example? Sometimes we don't want things on the default graph. We would like a child graph to hold some of our information. So we create a new graph. Not everything should, because I want to execute them separately. I want to execute the default graph separately in the session.run, then the child graph. So there could be some business requirement to do that. Okay. What is the purpose of creating a child graph? I think we discussed that. That is if you want to execute some of the things separately from the main branch, right? I want to reserve some of the processing to a different graph. I don't want some of the processing to happen as part of the main branch. Feed dictionary is like a collection, correct? Feed dictionary is a collection, and basically you use that to feed data into placeholders at runtime, okay? Persist data serialization, that is correct. So save and restore is a technique to save your model to disk for reuse later or for production deployment. For restoring model, do we need to give absolute file path? Yes. Yes, model is not stored in memory. Model is stored on hard disk. So you have to give absolute file path to restore the model. Otherwise, it won't find your. So when I say save, it gets saved to disk. It's like a file. It's a model file called with the extension .ckpt. So you have to give exact path so that it can find the pre-trained model. Our convolution layer, pooling layer of two-dimensional. See, those are just neural network layers. It has nothing to do with dimension. Dimension is around data sets, right? N-dimensional data, 2, 3, 4-dimensional data. Convolutional layer is useful for image processing, okay? Or, you know, neighborhood intelligence in you know, images and language. And pooling is one way of creating sparse neural network, right? Sparse, you know, output and reducing the overload on the computation, you know, hardware. And making neural network feasible, we need to do pooling. From which layer we can consider inputs as neural nodes? Well, it if you see, visualize a neural network, things come from the left and go to the right, right? Typically, when we draw a neural network like this, right? This is a neural network, right? So the signal normally flows this way. So this is input, right? This is how we normally put the neural network, right? Right, this is output. So the data flows this way, the gradient descent flows this way, right? If you know your gradient descent, the descent gradient slope backwards, the data flows forward, right? And each layer is adding a little more value to the intelligence problem, right? This is how neural networks work, divide and conquer, if you will. Okay, so we have convinced that we need to take ML class via this. Okay, what was this question? Presentation. Well, I appreciate that. So you are saying you like my presentation and you would like to take our ML class. Go for it. I'm very thankful to you. So look forward to your enrollments. Good basic intro of TF. Thanks. Thank you. For real-time detection, which model you suggest us to run in GPU machine? For real-time detection, I don't understand the question. What do you mean by real-time detection? Any idea on new capsule network? So there is a new algorithm called capsule network, which removes some facial misinformation which exists. Okay, so TensorFlow is supporting new capsule networks. So you'll have to Google it and find that information. I don't have it in my deck, but that's a new invention by Professor Geoffrey Hinton, father of deep learning. Okay, professor at University of Toronto, now with Google Brain team also. So new capsule network has come out to remove some of the regional problems which pooling had created in XPooling. Faster RCNN ResNet 101 gives us 1.5 FPS. Okay, I didn't understand the question. Can we consider convolutional layers as neural nodes? Absolutely. Convolutional neural network is also neural network. So they are neural nodes, absolutely. Okay, I don't see any other questions for now. Let me continue with a bit of career discussion. Then I'll take a few minutes to show you a small TensorFlow program since we are out of time. So, you know, as we always say, you can all kinds of people can come in AI and machine learning. If you are a developer, I do suggest you follow the technical data scientist track or technical track. Within that, the most glamorous area in data science is machine learning, deep learning. So that's the one I would recommend you take if you are a developer, right? Data science also had big data analytics using Hadoop, Spark. I don't focus on that. The most glamorous, the most exciting area of big data and data science now is machine learning, deep learning. So I suggest you follow this path and you can specialize in these other branches of, you know, machine learning and artificial intelligence, NLP, robotics, vision, driverless cars. If you are not a technical person, you can still train yourself to an AI specialist and you could continue to carry your usual career in consulting, program management, QC, marketing, or even sales, HR, or ops. Okay, so everybody can take AI specialization. We do have a course AI for managers. If you are a developer, recommended path is a technical data science track, and you all of you will be hot property. AI and ML is a very hot career area. There are probably is one data scientist to 30 open positions in the world now. Salaries are not a problem, as you know. So this is our, you know, sort of a 6-month program. So I teach all these courses myself online. So machine learning is the first course, deep learning is the second course, and advanced neural networks is the third course. So TensorFlow starts from the course number 2. Course number 1, machine learning, we teach with Python and scikit-learn library only. We don't need TensorFlow. So we start TensorFlow with deep learning in course number 2, and of course going into course number 3. Okay, in deep learning, we introduce basics of artificial neural networks, TensorFlow, optimization, regularization, gradient descent, all this, activation functions, loss functions. In advanced neural network, I teach convolutional neural network, recurrent neural networks, and also autoencoder, which is a specialized kind of neural network, okay, unsupervised learning. So it's a 3-course structure. It takes almost 6 months to complete. It's fully instructor-led. I teach these courses online. And you can start this series from our website. You can enroll one course at a time, or you can enroll in all the 3 courses. It takes about 6 months to complete. Each course has a certificate. If you finish all 3 courses with us, we issue a PG certificate in AI from CellStrat. And I teach these personally. We take each student very seriously. And I handhold them, guide them, mentor them. So we claim we create AI superstars. If you can successfully do all our assignments, all the hands-on assignments and projects in all of our courses, I guarantee you, you will have substantial expertise in machine learning and deep learning. But that said, I always say it takes 1 to 2 years to train an intermediate level data scientist. A 6-month program will give you a jump start. After that, I would hope that you would continue to do projects on your own with my help. And so that you have to give it another 6 months to 8 months after this 6 months. So total time of 1 to 2 years. At that time, you'll become an intermediate level data scientist and bid for fairly fantastic salaries available worldwide, including here in Bangalore as well. Okay. So you can check out these courses on our website. I'll continue. By the way, we are also starting this new concept of an AI lab. So our first, so this is a research and innovation lab in Bangalore. So this is only for deep learning experts in Bangalore. This is an in-person meetup we are doing this Saturday at our office in RMG EcoWorld near Belandur Outer Ring Road area. Those of you who are already expert in artificial neural networks and deep learning are most welcome to join this meetup this Saturday. And we'll be hacking GANs or Generative Adversarial Network along with CNN or Convolutional Neural Network. So we want to develop some cool image applications this Saturday in our office. So you are welcome to join, get your hands dirty with image processing applications, okay? So this concept of our AI lab is to create world-class disruptive AI applications and mutually participate in a joint AI research and innovation. Okay, that is the idea of our lab, to create a world-class research environment where we produce lots of disruptive global applications, okay? And we'll be meeting almost every Saturday, starting this Saturday, in our office in Bangalore. That was the session. Let me quickly show you some programs, if some of those of you are still hanging around. More than half the people are still here, that's great to see. Let me demonstrate some small code demos. So you see here, I'm implementing a simple, you know, x square y plus x plus b operation. Yeah. And you can, actually this should be y, I suppose. I should update this to y. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Come back here. Becomes x square y plus b, right? That's what we are doing here, if you notice. X square y plus b, b is 2. So this is just an execution of the code I already explained in PowerPoint. So remember, the total was coming to 42 because x was simply 3 and y was 4. So 3 square into 4 plus 2 equals to 40. Same code with placeholders now. So that was simply with variables. Now I'm doing the same thing with placeholders. So I call tf.placeholder here. And I am also declaring these variables w and w2. So I'm putting weights now on each of the expression. Okay, and B is bias B. And again, I initialize. And then what I'm doing, I'm using feed dictionary to feed different combinations of X and Y. So first, so I'm using X can be 1 or 0.6, Y can be 2 or minus 1.4. So there's a nested for loop. Okay, so first I try X1, Y2. Then I try x1, y1, minus 1.4, and so on. So first, I try with two values of x and two values of y, all possible permutations of x and y. Then I calculate the output z, okay? All right, and it calculates to this, clear? And the weight I have simply put as equal to 1, so there is no effect of weights. The bias I put as 2. So it, net effect is, it is the same equation as the top equation. So I do a session, I do global variables initializer, initialize the session under with, you know, and then I execute and feed the data using feed dictionary collection, as somebody said. And I can also work with arrays. So I can calculate some of that column, okay? I can create, so here I have declared a new placeholder, not to be confused with the previous placeholder. Here I have declared a new a shape three-dimensional tensor, 2 and 3, right? And then I'm converting it. So there are 6 cells because it's 2 and 3 simply. Then I create a two-dimensional structure, so it will become 1 into 6. Because total I can have 6. So my, as you know from shape command, reshape command. So reshape command means -1 means it will dynamically create the value of that dimension. Since it can have only 6 cells and 6 is already specified, this will simply become 1 in real time when it is computed. Then I am calculating the sum of the first axis, first column, and also the mean or the average of the each column. Okay, that's what I am doing. So here I declare in a feed dictionary called X array. It has values ranging from 0 to 35. So I just, when I say numpy.arrange, it creates 36 variables with values ranging from 0 to 35, and it's reshaped to this structure. Okay, so it will be 1 by 2 by 3 because it has to have total 36. Sorry, it will be 6 by 2 by 3, right? 6 into 2 into 3 should be 36. Total should be 36. So -1 will evaluate to 6 because 6 into 2 into 3 is 36. I need to hold 36 values. So this is my feed dictionary, and I feed it using feed dictionary command into my X2. What was my X2? X2 was my reshaped tensor here, right? Then I calculate the sum of each column and the mean of each column. Okay, so first I am printing X2 when feed dictionary has been applied. So you can see X2 comes out to be this, because I told you np.arrange 36 will create numbers ranging from 0 to 35, total 36 values, which you are created in the X2 tensor, which you are printed here. Then I calculate the sum of each column. So the first column takes sum of them 90, sum of second column takes sum of them 96, and so on. All right. Same thing, I calculate mean of each column. So mean of the first column is 15, mean of second column is 16. So I'm just printing them. So this was just some sample code with TensorFlow. Okay. So this we already explained. Let me show you a small linear regression program, but this is a little bit long program. Just try to explain it briefly. So this is implementing linear regression with TensorFlow. So again, I just create a training data. So I create 0 to 9. np.arrange 10 means 0 to 9, right? It creates 10 values, 0 to 9, reshaped into a tensor of 10 by 1. So a vertical tensor of 10 by 1. And then create the corresponding Y. So this data, if I were to plot on X and Y axis, would look like this, right? The way I declared this data, it would be simply this on a line. Okay, it would be like this. Because I'm trying to train a linear regression model, so I declared data set accordingly. Okay, let me go on here. Then I initialize the stuff. I'm creating a TensorFlow default graph here. Okay, and with global variables initializer. Create two placeholders for X and Y, right? Then I do weight, because in linear regression, the equation looks something like Y is equal to W into X plus B, right? This is your linear regression equation, if you know your machine learning, right? So I'm declaring variables W and B, which need to be trained, which are these, right? X and Y are placeholders. Then I'm printing W and B. Okay. Then I'm just saying W into X plus B. WX plus B, right? That's your Y expression. Then I'm comparing the predicted Y with the known Y, right? That is called mean square error, right? Mean square error is MSE loss Y minus Y square. So I'm squaring it here. Y minus Y dash square becomes mean square error, isn't it? And I take a mean of it. So that's how it becomes mean square error. Mean square error is also called my cost or loss function. I'm not using cross entropy loss. Here I'm using MSE or RMSE loss, if you know your machine learning. Then I use gradient descent optimizer with a learning rate. And I'm trying to minimize the mean square error, which is the cost or loss function, right? I'm minimizing it using gradient descent, using the optimizer. Then I create the linear regression model and we set up a function which actually runs the linear regression. So this is a function which actually runs the linear regression. It initializes the operation and then it runs so many epochs. So by default, I'm running 10 training loops. Okay. Feed dictionary, I feed the X train and Y train data set into my model and I use the optimizer to do the session run, minimize the cost or the loss. I keep appending. So I do it for, I do it in a loop. So I run this session number of times. I keep appending cost to this array called training underscore costs. Why? Because I want to plot how training cost goes down with number of epochs increasing. So here you can see there's as number of epochs increase, the training cost is going down, right? Training cost is going down. So my model is becoming more and more accurate, right? Cost or loss going down means model is becoming more accurate. So around here, I find sort of my ideal number of epochs. So about 3 epochs are fine for you to roughly minimize, or maybe 4 epochs to minimize cost or training loss. So this is just showing, you know, how training cost goes down with number of epochs, because I was storing the loss after each set of epoch runs, if you notice, because I was running this in a loop here. So I'm storing for each pass of the loop, I'm storing the cost that so that I can plot it against the number of epochs. So this is just a plot after running the training model, the linear regression model. And now I can also predict stuff. So I have trained model now. I can predict stuff, right? So I declare a prediction function. And I am predicting here. I just plot the predictions on the full data set, which is the X-train data set. So you can see the line fit after prediction is fairly good with very low. You can also use the print accuracy score of this model, which might hover around 90%. As visually you can see, the line fit is able to satisfy most of the dots to a great degree, right? So fairly good line fit. I don't need polynomial regression here. A simple linear regression found a line fit. I do not need artificial neural networks either. Simple linear regression done via TensorFlow did the job for me. So TensorFlow can do not only neural networks, but also classic machine learning algorithms like regression and also classification, right? So that was the session. Let me take up some questions now before we call it a day. Okay. Which Keras model is better for object detection? So I don't know what do you mean by which Keras model. So you are going to have to clarify that. I didn't know Keras had various models. So I thought Keras was only one. Maybe I'm wrong. Check it. Will you share the notebooks? No, I'm sorry. This is proprietary information. We share these notebooks with our students who enroll in our machine learning and deep learning training courses. Okay. So obviously there we have to give hands-on exercises. We share these coding with the training audience, not with the webinar audience. Any final questions before we call it a day? This webinar will be available on our YouTube channel after a few days. You can also find lots of other good webinars we recorded in the past on our YouTube channel. The link to our YouTube channel is available on our Meetup page. Any other questions? We are already 20 minutes over. I appreciate your patience and attention. Quite a few of you are still holding on. Any final questions before we call it a day? That was a lot of content for an hour, so it did take 20 minutes over. So thank you for your time and attention. I hope you enjoyed the session. So, okay, a question came up. Sorry, I don't know whether I'm correct or wrong. I thought VGG16, ResNet are Keras predefined model. Well, they are predefined models. I have to check if they use Keras or TensorFlow. But yes, they are predefined model. So that you can use them in your model training. Okay, so good night to all of you who are in India, and have a very good day for folks who are abroad in the Western countries. Have a good night, good day. See you later in the next webinar next week. Thank you.